So good morning dear students, welcome once again. Now let's continue our story further. If part 1 we need to summarize in short, we have seen up till now that Evans had got two visitors and Jackson and Stephens, both of them are visitors. They are prison officers who are working under governor's orders. They have come to check him before the commencement of the exam. As Evans had to shave himself, he requested them to leave and as he wanted to get ready. Now further, let's see. Now before moving out, Jackson remembers something and he turns his eyes on Stephens and utters to him, "Make sure you take his razor out of the cell when he's finished scraping that ugly mug of his, clear?" So he instructs Stephens that as soon as he completes shaving his ugly face, he has to make sure to take his razor out of his cell. Here mug word is used in informal way. Ugly means ugly face. Sorry, ugly mug means ugly face. Further, he adds that or else one day he would cut his bloody throat with it and do favor on them. So do favor here means doing such type of thing which would put them in the trouble. So Jackson wanted to take no risk at all. For some time, Evans kept looking thoughtfully at the man, means Jackson, who was standing ramrod straight. Actually, ramrod is seen in rifles. Usually, it is used either to clean the rifle or load it. It is a straight rod, like a stick. He observed Jackson was standing straight and a string of Second World War medals were proudly paraded over his left breast pocket. You have generally seen this paraded, medals on army officers' pockets, which shows their eligibility, their level of work, and this is the honor they have got. And suddenly he asked him, was it he who had taken his nail scissors away? So let's see next what happens. Here, further we can see that Jackson proudly take that nail file too and say, look. With this, Evans' eyes smoldered dangerously, means staring at someone very angrily. But Jackson was ready for him. He added, leaning forward, and leered his voice to a harsh, contemptuous whisper. Orders of Governor Evans. Further, he said, you want to complain? With this, Evans shrugged his shoulder lightly to show that it doesn't matter for him and the crisis was over. Evans tried to stop the crisis among them and the situation was normal once again. Jackson said Evans that he had got half an hour to smarten himself and shouts on him suddenly, Evans, take that bloody hat off. Me? Hat? Hat? Huh? Like that he says. So Evans put his right hand lovingly on the top of the filthy woolen and smiled sadly. Do you know, Mr. Jackson? It's the only thing that ever brought luck in my life. Kind of lucky charm. If you know what I mean. And today, I thought, with me, exam and all that. So here we can see Evans is trying to please Mr. Jackson emotionally, as it's my exam and this hat is my lucky charm. He knew that there was a tiny core of compassion, sympathy, somewhere buried in Jackson. And Evans knew about it. So here Evans tried to use the emotion and pleased Mr. Jackson. Now with this, Jackson feels that allowing to wear hat would not cause him trouble, as hat would not harm anyone. So he says, just this once then, Shirley Temple. Here in bracket we can see in your textbook that if there was one thing that Jackson genuinely loathed means hated about Evans, then it was his long wavy hair. Maybe you might have not understood the word Shirley Temple, which is used in the above sentence. She is an actress come dancer, singer, and she had a long wavy hair. So her reference is given in the textbook. Usually you know that girls have long wavy hair, and nowadays it's a trend for the boys to grow hair. But it's common now. But those days were different. Here Jackson gives reference of Shirley Temple and calls him by her name. So he calls out him as a Shirley Temple. So here two reasons we can see why Jackson allowed him to wear this bobble hat. Because when we will move towards the story, you will see that how bobble hat helps Evans in his plan. So here two reasons why Jackson had allowed is compassion and kind-hearted. And second thing was, he hated the most was Evans long wavy hair. He have never imagined that what Evans would do with that head. So further he said to get himself shaved fast. Now it's 8:45 a.m. Here the same morning we can see, and we can go to the different scene, and we can see that Reverend McClary left his bachelor flat in Broad Street and stepped out briskly toward Carfax. So Evans invigilator, you all know that McClary is going to invigilate him during the exam, who was staying in Broad Street. This is the name of the street. He had his bachelor flat. It means that he lived in the bachelor flat. Bachelor flat means, see, you can see in the picture that here everything, kitchen, bedroom, living room, everything you will find at the same place, in the same room. Then he hurriedly, briskly stepped towards Carfax. Now, what is Carfax? Carfax is also a place. It's a junction. It's a street. It is in Oxford, England. Now, in India also, you have seen so many streets, four streets which come together at same place. They come from the different streets. So, we say four roads, four streets, and the main point which we see, that is a middle point where the four street meet in Oxford. There was one place where such type of four street met, and that is called Carfax. And this Carfax was very near to HM prison. Now in short, we can assume that he was forwarding towards prison. So he was walking towards the prison, and then he had passed Carfax. Now one more thing, further we have got the information that it was reported by the weathermen that the temperature would be considerably below the normal for early June. So whatever the temperature is there in England during the June, it would be below the normal. It means that there would be cold on that day. Now let's see the description of the McClary. What type of things he had wore? He had wore a long black overcoat. I have tried to show the image. So see here, you can see he has wore long black overcoat, a shallow crowned clerical hat, which actually protected him from the steady drizzle, which started falling half an hour before. What is steady drizzle now? Just light drops of water falling down, light pour of rain, which is experienced before raining. It had now spattered due to the drops of water on his spectacles. Means the lenses were little bit blurred. You might have seen while moving in the car, you have seen this is the best experience. When we go for the outing during the rainy season, we can see that whole mirror where we drive, it's totally blurred due to the rain. So we have to wipe it out. So same thing happened in the spectacle, with the spectacles of McClary. See, I have added that photo. Now further, we can see that means he was just carrying a small brown suitcase. So here one more thing he had with him, that is small brown suitcase in his right hand. What it contained? Now what was there in that suitcase? All the material which he would need for the invigilation. So as he was going as an invigilator, there were some content which he had to carry for the invigilation. What were they? They were sealed question paper envelope, then a yellow invigilation form, then he had a special authentication form that is card. See, now while appearing for your exams, you need hall ticket. Without hall ticket, you are not allowed to sit in the center. Same authentication card from the board, it was given to McLaren. Then a knife, a current copy of Church Time. It is a newspaper, and he was carrying a Bible. A Bible because he wanted to speak to the Women's Guild. What do you mean by guild? That was a group where he was going to speak on Book of Ruth. So he was going to speak after the invigilation. So he was carrying that Bible also. Now, see the slide 4 here. You can see further the most important thing to remember is that 2 hours examination was scheduled to start at 9:15 a.m. At the scene in jail, now we will see the scene of jail. We can see that Evans was lathering, means shaving his face vigorously, means hurriedly, fast, when Stephen brought in 2 small square tables. He then set them opposite to each other in the narrow space between the bunk. Further, he brought 2 hard chairs. The slightly less battered. What do you mean by battered? So let us understand it in commerce point of view. In the terms of accountancy, any asset over the period of time becomes wear and tear, which is depreciated after using over a period of time. So here battered means used it for a long period of time and it needs somewhere repairing. So it should be depreciated. So here the chairs were battered, means little, it was not in a very good condition, and slightly battered of one of the chair he placed near the door. Now Jackson comes inside and showed his final appearance and told, "Behave yourself, lady," like that he told. And then now further he pointed to the pinups. So there were some holdings or pinups in his cell, and then he says, "And this off," means maybe there were some pictures hanging on the wall. So Jackson asked him to take those off. Evans turned and nodded and told that he was going to take them off anyway. Suddenly he asked, "A minister? Isn't he the chap coming to sit in? I mean," now here he added that as a person was the minister and hangings would be, see now if you will see that many times we see that bachelor stays alone without the family and they stuck many different photos. So these hangings would be of hero, heroine, sportsman, which your elders may not like. And here he's comparing himself with the minister. Minister in the sense in front of teachers and all, you will not try to show such type of photos or hanging. So he means to say that as he was the minister, he was anyhow going to remove all those hangings which he had hanged in the cell. Now Jackson quietly asked him, how had he known about the minister is going to come to invigilate? So Ivan suddenly informed that while signing the forms he came to know about it because they have taken some signatures on some forms. After lathering his left cheek, Evans asked Jackson if why they would have to bug him in the cell. While asking this question, he nodded his head vaguely to point about the door. And then Jackson considered was that the job was not done neatly. So he means to say that how did Evans came to know that they have attached some type of camera, micro camera, which Evans was pointing through his eyes. They're not honestly thinking I'm going to try to. So he tells that they feel that he was going to try to just break the jail once again. But before just completing the sentence, Jackson interrupts and continued, "They are taking no chance, Evans. Nobody in his senses would take any chance with you." And so now further, we can see that as he know that Evans is famous to break the jail and run. Already he did it twice before. And so he was called as Evans the Break, which we have seen prior in the part 1. Now Evans further asked him who was going to listen in. So as it was the camera, it was easily available, means it was easily available, means it was very easy for the governor to see and to listen that what conversation would go in his cell. So he's just concerned to know that who was going to listen. So with this, Jackson replied harshly, "Lady, I will tell you, it's the governor himself. See, he don't trust you a blood inch, nor do I. I will be watching you like a hawk. You are aware of this bird which has good eyesight." He walked towards the door and saw one more handkerchief was lying on the bunk, which was neatly folded square of white linen. So that cloth was white linen. And then further Jackson says to keep his nose clean. "Clear?" he asks him. Then he said last one thing, "Evans, good luck, old son." So nose clear means here he does not want to say something else like to keep with the help of handkerchief. Here he wants to say that don't do something wrong which they have to suffer. So he is trying to tell to behave properly. Now here further you can see inside now the prison's gate. Now here one more another scene. You can see that McLary has entered in the prison, and inside the prison gates, Reverend McLary signed his name in visitor's book and then walked with a silent prison officer across the exercise yard to D wing. So here the jail is very big, and you can see different wings are there in that, and so here reference is given. And here further we can see that he was greeted by Jackson. Now here heavy outer door was unlocked. First, as soon as he moved the door from the outside, the outer lock was very very heavy, and that was unlocked to make him to enter McLary. And then again, as soon as he entered, it was just locked behind him. Same they did for the inner door also. And then McLary was handed into Stephen's keeping. Now let's see what happens. Now here Jackson murmured to get the razor on the Stephen's knowledge. So Jackson says, "Take that razor which he's shaving." And so then for this, just he nodded his head. Further, Jackson also instructed Stephens to keep his skeet. It means that he has to be very alert. And Stephens nodded again. So he nodded his head and he told, "Okay." McLary with his new guide Stephens clanged his feet up the iron stairs and stood before the cell door. So when they were walking, the voice of their feet was clanging on the ears. Evans was able to understand that this McLary and some people are coming with them. And Stephens opened the peephole and looked through. And then for the cell outside, he tried to open the peephole. Now here, let's see the setting room of Evans before the exam, how it was. Now here, from the peeping hole, when Stephen watched, he saw that Evans was facing the door and he had sat quietly. His whole attention was at the textbook of elementary German grammar. And at the same time, Stephens opened the door with a thudded noise, thump, with a metallic twang, because the door was of metal. Now, at 9:10, and Governor switched on received and instructed Jackson, receiver, means he just calls Jackson and he asks that Evans' precautions have to be taken. Means he just is very much concerned, and he asks Jackson that whether all the precautions are told to Evans or not. He should be very fair for writing the exam. It is said that they were not taking any chance, and they thought, means in textbook it is written, whatever it is written, we are just trying to explore, that they were not ready to take any chance, and they thought that Evans should not spoil their preparation, and he should not understand that what type of preparations are done by the jail authorities. Wasn't it a bit theatrical? So here theater, in the sense what they want to say, like a dramatization somewhere. If you take the part in the drama, you can see such type of, so somewhere they were feeling that it was little bit too much. So they were doing something more, and something more precautions were taken. And because they want to say, how can Evans, means on the other side, they are thinking, governor is thinking, how can Evans try during his exam? How he can try? He's taking keen interest in his O-level exam. If he wanted to break, he would have tried it before from recreational block, because every day his teacher used to come and he used to teach him German language since last 6 months, and he used to sit in recreational block, and it was observed that he didn't try at all to run from the jail, and so he feels that it was much easy for him to break from recreational block instead in his cell. So then what happens further? Now he is in locked cell. Prison officers were alert. Two more locked doors between his cells and yards. Now here you can see that prior he was in recreational block, but now he was in his own cell and he was locked with lot of securities, and the yard was also consist with a wall as high as haystack. Haystacks you have seen, one by one, layer by layer it goes up. So that much high it was, the walls were that much high. So Evans was as safe as houses, no chance for him to escape. So they had done all type of preparations, but even though somewhere they thought that how Evans will try to run. Now in further we can see in the slide that anyway it wouldn't be trouble to have received turned on for next couple of hours. So means here he on the receiver, and he told that let the receiver be on, so whatever the conversation was going on, governor would able to listen. Nothing was actually there to listen, governor thinks, as invigilator's duty was to ensure the strictest silence during exam. So here one side he sees that he is going to listen to the conversation, on the other side he says that anyhow there will be nothing to listen because during exam he has to maintain silence. But there was one doubt: might Ivan take the advantage of McLary? They had taken all the pointed objects from Evans, but what about McLary? If he had brought anything unknowingly, a jackknife perhaps, governor thinks. Now it's 9:12 a.m. Governor informed Jackson on phone for what Jackson was suddenly confused, and then he called Stephens. Now there was a conversation between governor and Jackson. As you all know that governor was thinking that what was worrying him, and so something he had conversed with Jackson, because he was worrying that if McLary had something pointed object and Evans would hurt him, so he was little bit concerned, and so something such type of conversation was done by Jackson, to Jackson, and now Jackson called out Stephens and McLary out, and he explains about the governor worries, and then he asks him to check. So McLary patiently raised his arms. He allowed him to check. He checked his suitcase. But here you can see Stephens was puzzled when he saw something different. Now what things he saw? He had Holy Writ newspaper. These all things we have already heard before, and all this he was just checking it vaguely. He just shook to see that if anything was kept inside, but he found nothing. But one thing which puzzled Stephen was a semi-inflated ring. So it was not properly inflated. So the ring, many times you know that the ring, while swimming we use such type of rings. But here you can see that why he was puzzled was it was very small ring, where young child with a waist of 12 inches also couldn't enter. So he was confused that why he is carrying this semi-inflated ring. Means it was too small that even a small child would struggle to enter into it. So here somewhere Jackson was confused. And then suddenly Jackson kiddingly asked, because Stephens just discussed with Jackson, and then he was just jokingly, he asked, "Are you thinking to go for a swim, sir?" So here you can see further. McLary, hitherto amiable demeanor, was slightly ruffled by this tasteless listen, little pleasantry. This is very complicated sentence, students. So I want you to read it again and let's understand it properly. So McCleary, hitherto amiable demeanor, was slightly ruffled by his tasteless little pleasantry. Let's go reverse. Pleasantry, which means kidding, please, happy. Tasteless means there is no taste. Ruffled means bad. Demeanor means outer appearance. Amiable means friendly. Hitherto means till now. So let's understand this sentence once again. Up till now, McCleary's outer behavior means friendly behavior was slightly changed. So he had changed his attitude. Now little bit he was angry, and so you can see little bit bad behavior, weird behavior here you can see. He didn't like the Stephens asking him about swimming and whatever joke he had cracked on that. And it was tasteless for him. He thought that he is not able to understand, and for that he felt very bad. And then he was little bit hurted, and so he answered him sorely. If we must know, here we easy, if you will read this sentence also, it does not make sense. If we must know means what? You must remember here, you underline VE. It means that it refers to you. If you must know. Now see, you can make some sense. Here, VE was used for the old English writing. There are so many words here. You have gone through the short forms which author has used while writing in the story. So this all such type of words were used before. It was old. It is called old English writing. Now mostly authors don't use such type of words. So further, as he suffered from hemorrhoids, and when he sits for a long time, he needs it. He adds in his sentence. So he told, means then with listening to this, no, Jackson felt very sorry. And so he thought that, oh, he has this disease, he's facing such type of problem. What do you mean by hemorrhoids? Hemorrhoids means constipation. Jackson felt sorry, and he was embarrassed with which was seen on his red cheeks. Means here he felt really very bad, that means without thinking about what problem or why he has brought, without concerning about, he had spoke meaningless. And then moreover, what he found was paper knife which was under the newspaper. So here McCleary says that he has to take it from him. He cannot allow him to take this knife in his bag. So it was in Jackson's custody. Now further. Now it's 9:18. Here, Governor was able to hear the voices again. It was clear that exam was going to commence late, because we all know that the examination timing was 11:15. And now, due to the conversation between Jackson, Stephens and McCleary, little bit it was late, and now at 9:18 he was able to listen something. So let's see the conversation among McCleary and Evans. McCleary says, "You have got a watch?" Evans says, "Yes, sir." McCleary, "I will be telling you when to start and again when you have 5 minutes left. All right?" So once again there is silence. Further, McCleary informed that there was plenty more of writing papers if he needs it. Again there was silence. Then further, McCleary informs him to write the name of the paper, 021-1, in the top left corner. Silence once again. Then he instructed him to write index number 313 on the top right hand corner, and the box below that to write the center number 271. All right, he asked. Then there was silence once again. Now it was 9:20 a.m. So McCleary added, "Now I am going to." And suddenly Evans interrupted in between and said, "He is not going to stay here, is he?" See here, E'S. Here once again you can see the short form, he is. So he wants to say, "He's not going to stay here, isn't he?" So McCleary said, "He didn't know about that." Further, as Stephens was standing next to him and observing him constantly, even spoke those words. So further, he added, "How am I supposed to concentrate on my exam with someone breathing down on my neck? Oh, Christ." So see here, he says, "Oh, Christ," here as it is in England. Now, if you all have any problem, what do you say? "Oh my God, please help me." So such type here, he has used Christ. Then further, he says to McClary, "Sorry, sir, I didn't mean it." Then Stephen replied that it was the strict instruction given by his officer Jackson. All these conversations were heard by Governor, and so he calls Jackson and he asked him to get Stephen out of the cell. So as Governor's orders, Jackson has to follow. So Jackson replies, "As you wish, sir." Further, now here you can see that once again Governor heard some exchanges, voice exchanges in the cell, and the door clangs. Here at 9:25, McClary announced that the exam has begun. There was a great calm again. Here you can see that the exam was supposed to commence at 9:15, and now it was 9:25, so almost 10 minutes late the exam had commenced. Now once again at 9:40, there was a call from examination board, and the assistant secretary with special responsibility for modern language asks to speak to the governor. "May I speak to governor? I'm assistant secretary from examination board." He confirmed that how the exam was going on, and governor informed him that just the exam started before 15 minutes. He informed governor that there was a correction slip which some fool had forgotten to the place in the examination package. So they have not placed one slip which was to be corrected. So he calls him, and for that now governor feels somewhere scared, and he has dual thinking. Somewhere he feels that was the call fake, or it was a real call from the board. So here he is fearing that what sort of signal or message this is giving. So somewhere he has lot of burden to carry this exam in a proper way. We can see that Evans have already run, and he had broke the jail last 3 times. So here somewhere you can see that lot of burden governor has, and so immediately it strikes in his mind, and he cross checks that whether the phone was real or fake. So he dials the number of exam board, but heard only staccato blips. What do you mean by staccato blips? Ting, 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 ting. That is, the phone is engaged. So here you can see, up till now we are able to see that just the examination is commenced, and now there is a problem which is faced by the governor. And we will try to end our part here, and let's see that how the story moves ahead in the next part. Till then, bye, take care, be safe, and thank you.